Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Gang Politics, Revolution, Repression, and Crime by Kristian Williams. Foreword by Robert Evans. Narrated by Al Kessel. Foreword. Street Fights and Revolution in the City of Roses, Robert Evans. For almost 3 years now, I reported on the running street battles between Portland-area anti-fascists, the Proud Boys, and the police. In that time, I've watched the city's anti-fascist movement shrink from a broad popular coalition to a smaller, hardened core of activists. This is less reflective of anti-fascism's popularity in the City of Roses than it is of the danger of confronting the far right in the streets. Gunfire is now very close to guaranteed at any sizable confrontation. As Kristian Williams ably traces, the Proud Boys got their start as a gang. As we enter the Biden years, they might seem on the edge of morphing into an insurgency. This impression is deceptive, though. The Proud Boys have not gone out of their way to win the hearts and minds of the public. Instead, they've supplicated themselves to the levers of power. They've volunteered their time and efforts to act as an armed wing of the Republican Party and an auxiliary to the local police. The police in the Pacific Northwest have responded by allowing the Proud Boys and their affiliates to run wild without interference, so long as their targets are anyone vaguely on the left. Gangs and states very much exist on the same continuum, and the conflicts between them largely arise from the ability of gangs to challenge the state's monopoly on power. What we've seen with the Proud Boys is that many agents of the state are willing to approve the legitimate use of violence, as long as these foot soldiers for fascism do not fundamentally challenge their benefactors. As COVID-19 precautions are increasingly politicized, Proud Boys have been allowed to accost school board meetings and threaten schools themselves in the name of medical freedom. It was not until I read Kristian's work that I started to think about the Proud Boys and what they represent in a much more functional manner. At the end of the day, these far-right groups aren't just showing up to fight for the hell of it. They're presenting a very specific audience with an alternative view of what the state could be. The widespread refusal of American law enforcement to act against the Proud Boys suggests that this audience has liked what they've seen. On the other side of things, anti-fascists have come to increasingly resemble an insurgency. The growth of mutual aid networks accelerated in 2020 thanks to the pressures of the coronavirus and the BLM protests. This has led to a situation J. Edgar Hoover would have abhorred, and it has at times provided anarchism in particular with the best popular PR in modern U.S. history. But I have seen uglier things develop on the left as well. Kristian notes that anti-racist action and the Sharps started life as a gang, which turned toward the cause of racial justice. In some places, particularly Portland, I see a risk that organized anti-fascism will evolve away from this and shift more into the shape of a gang. I've seen elements of this on the ground in Portland, small groups declaring themselves security and using force, paintball guns and mace, on neighbors or fellow protesters who break the rules. Whoever fights monsters should see to it that, in the process, they do not become monsters. The same is true with fighting a gang like the Proud Boys. In the past year, I have watched as paintball and airsoft guns, as well as the indiscriminate deployment of bear mace, have gone from staples of far-right street fighters to ubiquitous on both sides. The appeal is obvious. When you're shot with a paintball, it's natural to want to shoot back. But I think yielding to the far-right in this way is its own sort of defeat. There are times when weapons must be used, but 9 times out of 10, a fire extinguisher loaded with paint does more damage than an airsoft rifle ever could. Rotten eggs damage gear more than paintballs. Raw force will always avail anti-fascists less than cleverness and surprise. Law enforcement would, of course, love nothing more than to see decentralized, horizontal packs of affinity groups turn into something more centralized, violent, and foolish. They would much rather deal with a street gang, engaging in running gun battles and casual brutality to bystanders, than a proper insurgent force that offers a compelling alternative to the state. In tracing the devolution of the Black Panthers and the history of the Blackstone Nation, Kristian provides rubrics for how the future of anti-fascism and the militant left might soon look. Today's activists would do well to pay attention to these historic examples. This is vital work, because only with such a rubric can we hope to avoid the missteps of the past. September 2021, Portland, Oregon. Questioning under caution, an introductory note. Bloods and Crips, Rangers and Panthers, Police and Thieves, Proud Boys and Antifa, Insurgency and Counterinsurgency, Revolution and Counterrevolution, Politics and Crime. How different are these? And how are they alike? In these three essays, written over the course of a dozen years, I explore the complex intersections between gangs and politics and argue that government and criminality are intimately related. The first essay, The Other Side of the Coin, examines the adaptation of the strategies and techniques of counterinsurgency warfare to domestic law enforcement, with particular attention to the policing of gangs. In the second essay, Gangs, States, and Insurgencies, I pose the next obvious question. If the police take a counterinsurgency approach to combating gangs, what does that suggest about the relationship between gangs and insurgencies and the state's attitude toward each? The third essay, Street Fights, Gang Wars, and Insurrections, applies my analysis to two groups that are often in the headlines, the Proud Boys and Antifa, and considers the ways that they each adhere to or diverge from the idea of a politicized gang, the degree to which that mode of organizing coheres with their politics, and the very different treatment each has received from the authorities. Throughout the book, I emphasize both the potential and the limitations of the gang form for liberatory politics. In a sense, a gang is an inherently political formation and set of activities involving the concentration and application of power, thereby influencing the distribution of resources within a community. The same may be said of the police, whatever the cops themselves happen to think about it. Both are therefore political, whether or not they self-consciously adhere to an identifiable ideology. When gangs do adopt an explicitly political program, the results tend to be mixed. Even with a new orientation, which will sometimes bring prestige and other benefits, they will nevertheless likely retain and be constrained by the gang's established structure, culture, and strategy. Ultimately, an organization's form may matter as much as the intentions of even its most powerful leaders. As I researched these questions, and especially as I saw their increasing relevance for contemporary events, my thinking on gangs changed considerably. I have edited the earlier writing to reflect the ways that my ideas have developed, but astute listeners may yet notice some shifts in tone, changes in perspective, and subtle differences in terminology between one essay and the next. To some degree, that is an inevitable, if unfortunate, result of repurposing material more than a decade after it was produced. But there is also an element of ambiguity and approximation inherent to the subject. Resisting definition. What it is that makes a group a gang is always contested, and the gang form itself may be more fluid than taxonomists would prefer. The Penguin Dictionary of Sociology offers under gang, this term is typically used to refer to small groups which are bound together by a common sense of loyalty and territory, and which are hierarchically structured around a gang leader. The more current and technical Eurogang definition, popular among criminologists, describes a gang as any durable, street-oriented youth group whose own identity includes involvement in illegal activity. The U.S. Department of Justice provides this definition. Gangs are associations of three or more individuals who adopt a group identity in order to create an atmosphere of fear or intimidation. Gangs are typically organized upon racial, ethnic, or political lines and employ common names, slogans, aliases, symbols, tattoos, style of clothing, hairstyles, hand signs, or graffiti. The association's primary purpose is to engage in criminal activity, and the use of violence or intimidation to further its criminal objectives and enhance or preserve the association's power, reputation, or economic resources. Gangs are also organized to provide common defense of its members and interests from rival criminal organizations or to exercise control over a particular location or region. In each case, criminologists try to encode in the definition conclusions about what I think must be and remain empirical questions concerning features like the gang's size, methods, purpose, effective ties, territoriality, structure, longevity, urbanity, demographics, public presentation, and self-conception. I find that on this narrow issue, the common sense meaning and even the pop culture stereotypes may have more going for them than the criminological definitions. If you consider what the gangs have in common in such varied films as The Gangs of New York, Boys in the Hood, The Warriors, and even West Side Story, I think you would have a pretty good idea of what people mean to invoke when they use the word gang. Equally troublesome is the concept of crime. In legal terms, of course, crime just refers to that body of illegal activity that can be prosecuted in the criminal courts, as opposed to being regulated by an administrative body, for example. But the term also carries a kind of moral implication, such that violations of certain fundamental norms, kidnapping, extortion, or murder, for example, may be coherently thought of as criminal, even when permitted by law and authorized by the state. Here there are two common sense meanings with a great deal of overlap, but some important distinctions. The essence of crime remains uncertain. As I hope to make clear throughout this slim volume, I consider this sort of indeterminacy to be an advantage. The blurring of these lines, the complication of our categories, is among my purposes in writing. Labels and frames. The authorities, especially the police, like to describe certain militant groups as gangs for a variety of reasons, some technical and some political. Most simply, a gang is a type of organization with which they are already familiar. The label brings with it an interpretive frame, a way of understanding the phenomenon. It allows the authorities to fit the new organization into their existing categories and procedures. They already have gang squads, gang files, and a range of laws and strategies designed for countering gangs. Labeling a group a gang is thus as much a matter of selecting the right tools for countering it as it is one of understanding the organization itself. Such ready-made templates, of course, risk oversimplification and error, but such may yet be preferable to confronting a novel, unfamiliar, and, for the moment, incomprehensible adversary. Then again, sometimes oversimplification is precisely the point. There is a propaganda value to calling your opponents a gang. The term itself, in respectable circles, is assumed to be both depoliticizing and delegitimizing. It denies the value or validity of any cause the organization may espouse, and it frames the countervailing police action as normal law enforcement rather than political repression. Naturally, as both crime and gangs are commonly conceptualized in racial terms, that is, racist terms, some groups are more likely to receive the gang label than others, and those groups operating among populations which are already over-policed and presumptively criminalized are the most likely of all. Interestingly, however, the gang frame can also justify police inaction or even indifference, especially in the case of right-wing gangs. Discounting the politics means that the authorities can ignore racist graffiti, meetings, and rallies rather than seeing them as part of a campaign of intimidation. Even actual violence, provided that it is directed against another gang, that is, against another opponent of the state, may receive minimal attention, being cynically treated as a case of one problem solving another. And by viewing both left-wing and right-wing militants as gangs, the police can treat them as equivalent, in effect, downplaying the violence of the right while exaggerating the violence of the left. Naturally, my interest in investigating gangs is entirely different from, and at many points directly opposed to, the cops' interest in doing so. And nothing I say in this book should be taken as justifying the childish notion that calling a group of people a gang automatically makes them the bad guys, or that designating one gang the police somehow makes them the good guys. Questions and interpretations. What is interesting to me is not whether the various groups I discuss here are gangs in some definitive sense, but whether they may be understood as gangs, whether or not they understand themselves that way, and what features and dynamics become apparent under that interpretation. I hope that this discussion may help inform our thinking, not merely about gangs, but also about a wider range of questions related to conflict, repression, legitimacy, and the state. Those questions are basic to any radical organizing, and our answers, or more often our unexamined assumptions, may determine a whole range of subsequent choices about the types of organizations we build, the basis of our solidarity, our political strategy, our tactical preferences, and the cultural expression of our values. The stakes here are sometimes absurdly high, and they are often more real than we allow ourselves to recognize. If nothing else, I believe the stories I tell in these essays underscore the need to take care how we organize, especially if part of what we are organizing is the capacity for violence. The Other Side of the Coin: Counterinsurgency and Community Policing. Prologue. Saving America. In August 2011, British Prime Minister David Cameron called William Bratton to ask his advice concerning the riots sweeping the United Kingdom following a police shooting. That is a curious and revealing fact, especially since Bratton's reputation as police chief in New York City, then in Los Angeles, was not built on his handling of riots or his response to controversies over police violence. He is known, instead, for declaring war on panhandlers and gangs. Given Bratton's heavy-handed, zero-tolerance approach and tough-guy reputation, his advice was also notable. Community policing is the philosophy that saved America in the 1990s, he told the BBC. It's about partnership, the police working with the community. To understand what these things have to do with one another, riots, gangs, zero tolerance, and community policing, it is important to understand the nature of counterinsurgency warfare. This essay argues that, despite the term's association with colonialism and Latin American dirty wars, many contemporary counterinsurgency practices were developed by police agencies inside the United States and continue to be used against the domestic population. Part 1. Repression, Counterinsurgency, and the State. Ends and Means, Legitimacy, and Statecraft. Counterinsurgency, coined in the military jargon, is not simply synonymous with repression, but has a narrow technical meaning which relies on the definition of insurgency. U.S. Army Field Manual 3-24, Counterinsurgency, explains, "An insurgency is an organized movement aimed at the overthrow of a constituted government through the use of subversion and armed conflict. Stated another way, an insurgency is an organized, protracted political-military struggle designed to weaken the control and legitimacy of an established government, occupying power or other political authority while increasing insurgent control." The definition of counterinsurgency logically follows. Counterinsurgency is military, paramilitary, political, economic, psychological, and civic actions taken by a government to defeat insurgency. Counterinsurgency, then, refers to both a type of war and a style of warfare. The term describes a kind of military operation outside of conventional army versus army war fighting and is sometimes called low-intensity or asymmetrical combat. But counterinsurgency also describes a particular perspective on how such operations ought to be managed. This style of warfare is characterized by an emphasis on intelligence, security, and peacekeeping operations, population control, propaganda, and efforts to gain the trust of the people. This last point is the crucial one. As FM 3-24 declares, legitimacy is the main objective. The primary aim of counterinsurgency is political. That's why, in the context of the U.S. occupation of Iraq, we heard career officers arguing that victory in combat is only a penultimate step in the larger task of winning the peace. And it's the need for legitimacy that they were referring to when they said, "Military action is necessary, but it is not sufficient. There needs to be a political aspect." The political ends rely in large part on political means. As the RAND Corporation's David Gompert and John Gordon explain, in COIN, the outcomes are decided mainly in the human dimension, by the contested population, and the capabilities of opposing armed forces are only one factor in determining those outcomes. The people will decide whether the state or the insurgents offer a better future, and to a large extent, which of the two will be given the chance. The RAND report is titled, appropriately, War by Other Means. War, as Clausewitz observed, is politics by other means, and politics, as Foucault reasoned, is war by other means. But in counterinsurgency, the means are not so other. In COIN, war fighting is characterized by the same elements as state building, establishing legitimacy, controlling territory, and monopolizing violence. What sets COIN apart from other theories of repression, I believe, is the self-conscious acknowledgement that the state needs legitimacy to stabilize its rule, and that under conditions of insurgency, its legitimacy is slipping. In other words, from the perspective of counterinsurgency, resistance is not simply a matter of the population, or portions of it, refusing to cooperate with the state's agenda. Resistance comes as a consequence of the state failing to meet the needs of the population. It is possible, therefore, to see COIN as representing liberal or even radical politics. Yet such apologetics miss the larger point. As a matter of realpolitik, the authorities have to respond in some manner to popular demands. However, COIN allows them to do so in a way that preserves their overall control and, in the best case, amplifies it. The purpose of counterinsurgency is to prevent any real shift in power. Counterinsurgency is all about reclaiming the state's authority. Violence and territory are inherent to the project, but it is really legitimacy, the consent of the governed, societal support that separates the winners from the losers. As Gompert and Gordon put it, the key in COIN is not to monopolize force, but to monopolize legitimate force. The strictly military aspects of the counterinsurgency campaign are, of course, necessary. But so are the softer, subtler efforts to bolster public support for the government. Both types of activities have to be understood as elements of political power. The social science of repression. To meet the challenges of counterinsurgency, first in restless colonies, then domestically, the security forces have had to shift their understanding of intelligence. Since the cause of an insurgency is not just a subversive conspiracy, but necessarily connects to the broader features of society, the state's agents cannot simply ferret out the active cadre, but need to aim at an understanding of the overall social system. The U.S. Army's Counterinsurgency Field Manual, FM3-24, incorporates this perspective, arguing that strategists require insights into cultures, perceptions, values, beliefs, interests, and decision-making processes of individuals and groups. This sort of intelligence work is concerned with questions that are primarily sociological, and so a great deal of FM3-24 is concerned with explicating basic social science terms like group, coercive force, and social capital. In fact, the entirety of its Appendix B is devoted to explaining social network analysis and other analytic tools. It specifies, a social network is not just a description of who is in the insurgent organization. It is a picture of the population, how it is put together, and how members interact with one another. FM3-24 specifically suggests analyzing historical documents and records, interviewing individuals, and studying photos and books in order to draw an accurate picture of a network by identifying bonds formed over time by family, friendship, or organizational association. As one RAND Corporation report explains, counterinsurgency requires that the security forces collect both information on specific individuals and information in which the actions or opinions of thousands, perhaps even millions of people, are highlighted. This broader approach changes the type of information they're seeking and also the means they use to collect it. The same report emphasizes, even during a security operation, the information needed for counterinsurgency is as much or more about context, population, and perceptions as it is about the hostile force. Only a small fraction of the information needed would likely be secret information gathered by secret means from secret sources. Properly analyzed, the RAND researchers tell us, the information the state collects can be used in five types of activity. 1. Police and military operations, such as sweeps, roadblocks, or arrests. 2. Assessments of progress in the counterinsurgency campaign. How many people have been hurt or killed in the war? What kind of crimes are being committed? Who is getting employment and where? And who is staying put or leaving the country? 3. The provision of public services, whether security and safety services, for example, an efficient 911 system, or social services, for example, healthcare, education, and public assistance. 4.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.